She had the it factor instantly.
She just has that innate honesty. This is it. Hope you like it. I ain't gonna change. I'm Reba McEntire, and that's what you're gonna get.
Reba is so comfortable in her skin. She can sing. She can act. She has a clothing line that's hugely successful.
She says, I don't believe in limitations. I only believe in opportunities and possibilities.
She went beyond what everybody else was doing.
There were imitators who just could not do it. It takes someone with a technically staggering voice.
She expanded country music into a new realm.
She had a path, and she didn't stray from it.
You do have to have a backbone, because you're going to come up against a lot of people who tell you you can't do this, you can't do that. And you're going to have to stand up and say, oh, yes, I can, and watch me.
She has sold more than 55 million albums. Her tours constantly grossed as much as U2, Springsteen, and the Stones. And she stretched the boundaries of country music until the seams burst.
Boom, 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 boom. Big explosion, and she's standing there. It was the most amazing opening I've ever seen, not for a country artist, but anybody.
Her tours had everything from multi-stages with pyro, 15 costume changes in an hour, 20-minute show. It was over the top.
And most of that, Reba never left the stage. It all kind of happened before your eyes. And then I got me a Georgia mansion
in an elegant New York town. Every person that walks out of her concert believes that she was singing directly to them. I mean, she has that gift.
She and Norval would always just dream up these extravaganzas, and I think we definitely learned something from that.
We caught that bug. Yeah.
It was a whirlwind. We had more lights up than Madonna or Michael Jackson.
To them, it was more important to make the fans happy and have everybody leaving wanting more.
It was a three-ring circus, to say the least. It was wonderful.
You got everything you ever wanted when you went to see a Reba McEntire show.
She went beyond what everybody else was doing, and she expanded country music into a new realm. People from the city loved country for the first time.
Sold out concerts, country hits, millions of albums sold put Reba McEntire literally on the map. Her company, Starstruck Entertainment, built its headquarters smack in the middle of Music Row, the heart of Nashville's music scene. Her style was pure country, and like Madonna and Cher, her name was a brand recognized worldwide. But it was always the voice. You knew it was Reba when you heard the voice.
I charmed a king, a congressman, and an occasional aristocrat. And then I got me a Georgia mansion in an elegant New York townhouse where I ain't a man.
She sings hard and strong, and there's nothing timid about her.
She brought in an almost athletic style of singing that was a lot different from the country artist who had come before. You know, she can stretch a syllable into four or five.
She also has stylized her deal. I mean, it's obvious she makes a lot out of a note.
That's Olympics.
Yeah. Nobody sings like her, you know. That's part of being heard on the radio and know immediately who that is.
From the time that she began her real run in the mid-80s, she's had a great relationship with radio. But, you know, that's like saying, well, once I struck it rich, I had a really good relationship with the banker. She was giving him the goods.
An American Idol winner standing beside her idol, Reba McEntire. Because of You was yet another in a long string of country hits for the Oklahoma native.
One good thing about Reba, she's not selfish with her fame. I'm good, she's good. together would be great. Because of you,
I am afraid. Her musical prowess has set her apart from the competition, and her tough childhood prepared her for the challenges she would face as a female in the music business.
I think women probably have always had to work a little harder because we have a lot to overcome. Most of all, I think it's because a lot of people don't realize that some of us are strong enough.
Getting in the music business, I'm like, well, crap, here it is again. I'm going to have to work harder just like I did when I was growing up. I'm going to have to do 3 times more than what the men do just to keep up. And if I'm going to beat them, I'm going to have to do 5 times more. And that's what we did.
She's one of the few iconic females that have done it. And, I'm going to take female out of the conversation. She's one of the few people that have done it.
What she comes against now in her career is nothing compared to what we dealt with at home.
The woman who would sell millions of albums, mount concerts, and sell tickets that would rival any superstar grew up in Chalky, Oklahoma, population 18. Reba Nell McEntire was born March 16, 1955, the third of 4 children to Jackie and Clark McEntire on a 7,000-acre cattle ranch. Her father was a champion rodeo cowboy and her mother a school teacher.
Mama had 4 kids in 5 years. I think if Daddy didn't rodeo, they'd have had 20 children. Mama went through high school, and she would take the bus. She'd ride her horse over to the highway and then take the bus to Durant for her college education. And she'd teach school during the winter, and summer she'd finish her college education. And so Mama had a full degree. Daddy barely made it through the 9th grade.
Our family was pretty poor, if you really looked at it. My daddy borrowed money to buy cattle. And so you were on, not that we were put on a budget, but we just kind of lived budgetedly.
It was Alice, Peg, myself, and Susie.
There were no other children for Miles, so her brother and sisters were the only playmates she had.
We hated each other. We loved each other. We were in competition with each other. We did everything together. And our escape was the roping pen. We stayed down there until dark, and Mom would be hollering, "Dinner!"
Our meal times were fun, especially when Daddy wasn't there, because it was kind of, we could sing at the table when Daddy wasn't there.
Reba made her debut singing Away in a Manger in the 1st grade. Singing was fun and an escape, as life at home wasn't easy, especially for the girls.
Working on a ranch with a bunch of men, having to be down there working at the pens, lunchtime, you took them out in oysters, you cleaned them, you took them to Mama, she fried them. We prepared the meal.
Cook, clean up while Paik and Daddy laid down on the floor, took a little nap, and then we were expected to go right back down there and work some more.
We did both jobs all our lives, Alice, myself, Susie, and Mama. And that's feeding, working cattle, everything.
It was all she knew, so Reba adapted to life on the ranch.
I was a tomboy. I didn't wear makeup until probably 10th, 11th grade.
We didn't have the abilities to fix hair or to put on makeup very well. We looked awful. We looked absolutely awful when we were kids.
I absolutely loved school because I got to go and have friends and see other people and go home with them. Because when I had to come home, I had to work. I played basketball from the 5th grade on. I lived and breathed basketball.
She went to a lot of the basketball camps, and then that was where she got to sing for the girls, too. She would take her guitar, and she would sing for the girls and entertain them.
When basketball season wasn't on, I was riding my horse, and when Alice went to college, I'd keep her horse legged up. I'd ride him for an hour. I'd come in on Monday night and watch It Takes a Thief, and then I'd take my horse out, and I'd exercise him, and that was my routine.
Growing up, Reba was busy, but she always made time for her music.
We had a little country western band, and we played for proms. We had concerts to raise money. And then on the sideline, we'd take our instruments, we'd borrow from the school, and we'd go play clubs.
In our singing, Mama was the referee.
Paik was the MC and the lead singer, and Susie and I were the harmony singers.
When we would be fighting over who was on whose part and who was flat and who was sharp and who wasn't singing the part in the right place anyway, Mama would have to come in and referee us.
In 1973, Reba graduated from high school and headed off to Southeastern Oklahoma State University in Durant, where she began to enjoy life in the big city.
She would party at college, I guarantee you. You just ask me, she partied.
It wasn't very far to the Texas-Oklahoma state line, and beer was a little more potent in the Texas state than it is in Oklahoma. So we'd go across the border to a place called Arnold's Club, and I would sing at this club. I'd get up with the house band and sing, so I thought I was furthering my career.
With her musical career well in hand, she pursued her love of rodeo, entering over 50 rodeos a year.
I was part of the rodeo team, and Beth Crump, my roommate, she also was a barrel racer, so we'd go rodeoing on the weekends.
Barrel racing? That's kind of like getting on a dragster.
Yeah, no kidding.
In sand and going as fast as you can go, flying around barrels at 100 miles an hour.
That was my lifetime goal. That's what I wanted to be, was a champion barrel racer.
In an inspired bit of parenting, her father encouraged both her career aspirations in a single stroke.
Daddy kept saying, Reba, why don't you get you a job at the National Finals Rodeo? I said, well, all right, what do you think I ought to do? And he said, well, get a job singing the national anthem.
With her cowboy hat on her head, Reba McEntire stepped up to the microphone.
Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light?
In attendance that day, along with thousands of people in the stands, was host of the event, Red Steagall. Red, a longtime friend of Reba's father and fellow rodeo veteran, was a country and western singer with some local and national notoriety.
When she was singing the national anthem at Oklahoma City for the National Finals Rodeo, it was there that Red Steagall said, wow, that girl can sing.
Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wear?
Reba spent her school years pursuing her main interests, barrel racing and singing, and she was good at both. But it was a chance hearing of her solo performance of the Star-Spangled Banner at the National Finals Rodeo that opened the door to taking her singing talents to the country music capital, Nashville, Tennessee.
Oh, say does that Star-Spangled Banner yet wave o'er the land?
Red Steagall, a country and western artist, felt that Reba's promise lay in her vocal talents and not her ability to round the barrels on a horse.
Mama got a call from Red. He said, Jackie, I've been thinking about Reba. He said, what if I took her to Nashville and see what we can get done and then maybe bring the other two kids in later?
At first, Reba and Susie were singing harmony, backing up their brother. But over time, Reba's talents pushed her up front.
At that point, Paik and I were singing together with Reba, and she came to us. We had a family meeting, and she said, if I go to Nashville, that's going to leave you guys behind. And we said, oh, you go ahead. You go ahead and you do what you do, and maybe you can help us along.
The decision to leave her brother and sister behind was difficult. Reba had never been on her own and was still uncertain about a career as a singer.
Later on that year, Mom and I went to Nashville and recorded some songs that Red had written. Polygram Mercury heard my songs and liked the songs and took my cassette tape up to their quarterly meetings and signed me up in 1975.
The next step was to wait out the reaction to her songs from country music fans and radio. While awaiting the verdict, Reba returned to college and the rodeo, where a champion roper, Charlie Battles, caught her eye.
Charlie was fun. He was rodeoing at the time. He was older than Reba, kind of took up that father figure maybe in her life. She felt like that he was just going to kind of fulfill her life and protect her, keep her safe.
After graduating from college on June 21, 1976, Reba married her rodeo sweetheart at the Baptist Church in Stringtown.
Charlie and I were living in a $10 a month rent house there in Chalky, hauling our own water, and we'd had to jack the floor up twice, and ceiling had fallen in twice.
To add to the couple's woes, Charlie's rodeo career was fading, and Reba's musical career was still a struggle.
I was singing honky-tonks, beer joints, rodeos, nightclubs, dance halls, and the smoke was so bad, and I was so allergic to it and the dust from the dancing, you know, kicking up the dust.
For a performer with a Nashville recording contract, the travel was less than first class.
They'd be in a pickup truck and a U-Haul trailer, and then I'd follow along in the pickup and camper. And then we graduated to pickup and campers and a trailer, horse trailer, with all the equipment in the back. The band would have to change clothes in the trailer, move the horse manure out of the way.
I remember seeing Reba come off out of her little trailer backstage, and she had on a cowgirl outfit.
Country girl, the peasant skirts, and of course her being a real cowgirl, she had those boots, that belt buckle, and that was her, and it fit her music.
I would get through playing a club, and Susie and I'd go back to the room, and I dreaded closing my eyes so bad because they would burn, and just tears roll down.
After 3 years of enduring the small time and still believing better days could lie ahead, Reba had finally had enough. She reached out to Charlie for support.
I called Charlie, and I said, tell the agency I don't want to play any more clubs. And Charlie said, what? I said, I can't do it. I said, it's just killing me. And my lungs are hurting, my eyes, my sinuses are killing me. I'm losing my voice. He said, well, you won't have any place to play. You won't have a career anymore. And I said, well, I won't have a voice to sing with, so it won't matter.
I worked for her on the road, so I was close to her relationship with Charlie. I knew how difficult he was, you know, to work with in an office situation. And I knew how it was when she would come off the road and his attitude towards her.
Charlie really wanted more of a wife, someone at home a little more. And Reba was like a filly just ready to run. She had had a taste of it.
She called me on the phone in desperation. And I know she was wanting me to be a friend and a sister. And I, without slapping her, I slapped her. Because I said, oh no, you can work it out. Don't divorce.
Despite the words of her sister, Reba had decided her marriage was over.
I've always trusted my gut, knowing when something's right and when something's wrong. You gotta realize that's the truth and go with it.
I do think the divorce made her stop and think, and she really had to reconfigure and begin again in many ways.
Her marriage over and her determination for a career in music at the brink of exhaustion, an unexpected offer to open for one of country music's most acclaimed groups, provided a ray of hope for the struggling singer.
If it wasn't for them, I don't know what would have happened.
With a recording contract in hand and a ring on her finger, Reba had hit the road. But after 3 years of playing at smoky beer joints and honky-tonks, all she had left was a marriage on the rocks and deep questions about her career. Then an unexpected call came.
Statler Brothers are looking for a girl singer to open their show. The Statler Brothers not only saved my voice, they saved my career.
The Statlers were a popular country touring group. They had just lost their opening act, Barbara Mandrell, who was launching her solo career, and they offered Reba the job.
She toured a lot during that time, so she was able to build a kind of grassroots fan base.
She gained fans and confidence during her time with the Statlers, but her records failed to make an impact.
It was 16 singles before she got her first number one hit. Nowadays, if you don't hit with your first or second single, you're gone.
She signed a deal in the mid-70s and had not begun to really become a major hit maker until 1982.
There's a saying on Music Row, everybody's 3 minutes away from being a star. And she was.
With her recording career stalled, Reba made a bold decision. She opted out of her first record contract and signed with MCA, a label that recognized her untapped potential. She convinced them to let her control her sound, her songs, and her image.
Most artists were not able to come off years of not being terrifically successful and not making a record label a lot of money and somehow demand some creative autonomy. That was unusual.
It's more rare than you think. And she was able to do that and stand her ground.
When you're a young artist, the record companies and producers try to control you of who you are, or who they think you are, or who they want you to be, or who they think the public wants you to be.
That's only going to go so long and so far, and you're going to just one day just rear up and say, it's this way or no way.
She had to buck against some of the sonic trends of the day.
She knew she had to latch on to her sound and what a Reba song is.
Reba finally found the collaboration she needed at MCA, a company with a long track record of success with some of the greatest female country talent in history, artists such as Patsy Cline and Loretta Lynn.
Figuring out the kind of material that she wanted to do and getting to a place as a hit-making artist where she was going to get the A-level songs, the switch to MCA proved very helpful.
Jimmy Bowen, who had taken over MCA Records at that time, told me, he said, if you want more control over your music, you need to go find the type of songs you want to sing. We went to the publishing companies and we found a song called Whoever's in New England. And so we recorded that, and that was my first video.
It was kind of a sophisticated cheating song.
Business must be booming, or could something else?
Here you got a song that mentions Massachusetts and is about, you know, the wife of a white collar professional. And that was a different kind of thing for country music.
When whoever's in New England's through with you.
So there was an audience of people who heard that song who weren't into the, you know, rednecks, white socks, and blue ribbon beer kind of country, who thought, oh, that woman in the song, her story sounds something like mine.
She could tell a story with her facial expressions. Don't forget, there's no dialogue in these things. So it's actually 10 times harder to have an emotion with a facial expression or a shoulder or this and that than it is to say the words.
The first time I saw the music video, Whoever's in New England, my first thought was, this lady is an actress.
Just one thing you want to know. When the icy wind blows through you, remember that it's me.
In 1987, Reba won a Grammy for Whoever's in New England. The impact cemented her position as one of the top artists in country music, and she had found both professional and personal support from a band member.
The one person who totally believed the way I did was Norval Blackstock.
Several years earlier, a young, handsome steel guitar player had joined her band.
The first job that Narvel played with us, Paik and I were singing with Reba at Nowata, Oklahoma. And I think he thought we were the biggest hicks in the world.
I meet Narvel, say hi, and notice he's a very good-looking gentleman, kind of a city guy.
And I remember him sitting over there. Oh, he's just gorgeous. He was just the gorgeous specimen of a man. There was a chemistry between them. And they started becoming really good friends.
Ended up being the tour manager. He's a very smart guy. And when you're a tour manager, you spend a lot of time with the lead artist, which was Reba, of course.
He would go shopping with her. They would go do stuff together. And then they fell in love.
We were working a lot before Narvel and I got married. I was doing a movie, my very first movie, called Tremors.
You know, Reba is great in that movie. Yeah, it's a wild and crazy movie, but it is well done. And what just makes me laugh, and what I remember most, is her line where this monster, actually, they realize, has a smell.
Stinks too.
Love it.
When Reba made her first film, Tremors, which today is a classic film. It's out there all the time. It's amazing. I just laughed. You know, I know her so well that it was just the regular Reba. She was gun-toting Reba. That was her. And she is a gun-toting girl.
I go for penetration, the 458, shooting solids, less ammo to carry.
Come on, Bert, move it!
On a short break from filming and in the midst of a scheduled concert, Reba and Narvel squeezed a wedding into their hectic schedule.
We had the show Friday night, and then the next day we got married at Emerald Bay on Lake Tahoe. And then we did our first show, had our wedding reception in our suite, and then did another show and put everybody on the buses, took them back to the airport in Reno.
I think that's the greatest thing that she ever did, was partner up with Narvel.
I think they both really admire the other's talents, and that's
you know, as far as business goes. If you got to go home with each other at night, it's not like they always agree either. I think that's what...
They're very, very normal.
He watches out after people, and he's very fair. He's honest.
In my eyes, the perfect couple. It doesn't mean they're perfect, like they never fight and they don't have moments. They're perfect because there's always respect.
Love is an added benefit. It's icing on the cake, but if you don't have that respect, it's over.
By the early 90s, Reba's career was soaring. She won 4 Female Vocalist of the Year awards and the coveted CMA Entertainer of the Year. Her concerts were sellouts and her records were flying off the shelves. She'd married the love of her life, but then the unimaginable happened. Minutes after the jet-carrying members of Reba's band and her tour manager took off from Brownfield south of San Diego on March 16th, the plane's wing clipped an outcropping of rock near the peak of Otay Mountain. Before the crash, they had performed at a convention for IBM. Reba had decided to skip the flight at her husband's urging to get a good night's sleep and speed her recovery from bronchitis.
The plane crash in 91 was a horrible thing to go through for her and the whole touring group.
When you're on the road like she is, those people are your family.
She suffered more than any of us will ever know.
I told Narvel, I said, I don't think I'll ever be able to get on stage again without them.
With her new husband and business partner sharing her vision, Reba's career was soaring. Movie roles, awards, platinum albums, and sold-out concerts. Her dreams were coming true. But then in 1991, tragedy struck as a plane crash took the lives of 7 of Reba's band members and her road manager.
Tragedy, a horrible tragedy, one that we think of often, one that we wonder what would they be like today.
I can't imagine anybody dealing with it more gracefully, especially publicly, than she did.
She said, I've got to keep going, just for me, if not for everybody. And she was really strong like that.
She was criticized for it, for going right back into her work. But if you think about it, that band believed in what she did. They backed her. They played behind her every night, and they loved her.
The one constant in Reba McEntire's life was hard work. Following the crash, she knew the only way back was to work even harder.
She tried to, you know, put her boots on and pull the straps up and get back in the saddle, and she did it.
She did it with a breakthrough video and a song, Fancy.
The Fancy video, that was at a time when the videos were just starting to break away from the music and interject some spoken word.
Sorry, what'd you say?
I said, are you just passing through or are you going to stay for a while?
No, I'm just passing through.
Oh my gosh. You know, to me, Fancy was yet another turning point for Reba. She has a lot of turning points. And when she did the video, had all the costumes, and played Fancy to the hilt, you just knew something special was going on with her. But man, she attacked that song vocally. But I couldn't see spending the rest of my life with my head hung down in shame. You know, I might have been born just plain white trash, but Fancy was my name. It's like she was living out the life of Fancy. And I think that's what fascinated all of us about it.
I thought the song was a great song, but I thought the production and her performance of it, and that she made it the centerpiece. In fact, I think she used to end with it. I knew what I had to do when I made myself this song about that I was gonna be a lady someday, though I didn't know when. But I couldn't see spending the rest of my life with my head hung down in church. But I remember the band still playing Fancy, and we were in the limo leaving the venue. I mean, the crowd was still screaming. And, you know, it's like Reba has left the building.
for some reason, when we find a talented person, when we find someone who's good at something, it just surprises the heck out of us when it turns out that they're good at something else.
The game tomorrow to see who takes the money to San Francisco.
I've traveled a long way over hard ground because you told me I had a stake.
And you do, as soon as you clean out the other contenders.
She's just a natural at whatever she does because she adapts and she learns. Her mind is open.
You all right?
It hurts, but I'll be fine. That Kate don't take criticism too well, does he?
I guess not.
But if there's a part that has a strong personality, that she could do it.
How do you memorize a script? How do you do that? And I can't remember the words, songs I've known for 20 years. She loves it. She says, well, I love it. She says, and they'll throw changes at me that quick. She just shows you how smart she is.
I think she loves the challenge of, okay, what's this character? How can I crawl inside this character and make her believable?
Fine, I'll just find my own way to the game.
Not on your own, you're not.
She's always known that she's funny. She's always known that she would like to try acting. And she goes to Hollywood and makes it happen.
Lucy, what are you up to? Oh, hi, Ethel. I'm fixing my very first Thanksgiving dinner for Ricky.
So perfect that the humor side of her acting has done so well for her because she's a naturally funny, witty girl. So it's not surprising to me that that has been what rose to the top.
Oh, she can mimic Lucy very well. She loves Lucy, and she kind of idolized her a little bit.
In her personal life, Reba faced another milestone, motherhood.
Motherhood and how it has changed her is something that she has kept inside of her. She hasn't made a big deal out of, you know, coming out and being Mother of the Year. She never put Shelby on parade.
Motherhood kind of evened her out a little bit. I think when Shelby came along, going to PTA meetings and going to baseball games.
Typical mom, but it's kind of hard to envision, you know?
If you didn't know she had a child, you would think that she's just been businesswoman and superstar her whole life.
I think it was good for her. I think it rounded out her life.
As Shelby was growing up, not having him with her all the time. She waited a while to be a mom, and she had this beautiful baby, and that was hard for her.
Stop it, that's mommy's heart.
Reba was determined to manage the delicate balancing act of parenthood and her career.
Oh, no.
What have you done? I've been working on that piece for 3 weeks now. Why did you do that?
I didn't mean to. I'm sorry, Mommy. It was an accident.
I don't need any more accidents in my life.
She was always interested in pushing boundaries, and she was never afraid to put herself out there as an actress in the videos.
It's one of those songs that made other songwriters angry because they didn't write it. Because it was so on target about the way people and women in particular feel trapped. It's not like she didn't love her kids and love her family. That was a really breakthrough, honest kind of thing to say, to go, you know, kind of looking out the window going, what else is going on? What am I missing? Is there life
out there? So much she has. I need an answer from someone. O'Connor.
She saw that as a very important vehicle and as a way to get the message of that song out and to indelibly burn the image of that song and video package in the minds of the consumers, the fans.
That is always a big theme in her music, is picking yourself up and starting over. And I think for women, that's a really important message, and to know that you can. You know from talking to Reba herself that she's had those feelings in her life. Is this all there is to this marriage? Is this all there is to this record deal? Is this all there is to the business? But her answer to those questions was always no, hell no.
The part of Reba McEntire that seemed to connect with a lot of women was the part of Reba McEntire that seemed to scare a lot of men on Music Row.
Reba asked me, so what are we gonna do for this new duet I'm doing with Linda Davis, Does He Love You? And I just looked at her and I said, let's kill the guy. And she went, ooh, I like that.
The 1990s found Reba in high gear. She had rebounded after the loss of her band and the plane crash and embraced motherhood. Her videos were setting new standards and providing her a chance to try out acting. Her music was reaching the top of the charts, and she had an extraordinary appeal to the female audience.
I think women can relate to her in the same way they do Oprah. I think they know she's honest. I think they know she's been there. I think they know she feels it and that she's telling the truth.
She sings songs that are real and that deal with, of course, everyday problems and dilemmas and feelings and heartache. In your arms is where he wants to be,
but you're the one. Linda Davis's vocals were one of the few people, she's one of the few people who could match Reba on stage. I mean, you can't just drag anybody out there and have them hold up the other end of that song, they'd get slaughtered. But does he love you? Does he love you? Like he loves me. Like he loves me. Does he think of you? Does he think of you when he's holding me?
The first time I heard the song Does He Love You, and I saw the music video, I thought, this is insane. Women don't normally like to get out there and talk about the infidelities in their relationships. And this hit it head on, giving you both sides of the situation.
John Small's video for Does He Love You started up a huge controversy, maybe because we blew things up and simulated blowing people up on a boat. And that was a little drastic, I think, for a video world at that time.
Cut! Beautiful! Reba, come here. Take a look at this.
We got, yeah.
In the end, it all turned out to be a movie within a movie, and the movie was actually directed by Rob Reiner. The song was loved by everybody, and hey, she won a Grammy.
The controversy over Does He Love You paled compared to Reba's next controversy.
The red dress from the very first sketch, in my mind and in my design, was always meant to be very low and barely covering, you know, and that's what it was.
Narvel came in and I said, what do you think about this? He said, oh my gosh, Sandy. She said, oh no, I'm gonna sprinkle beads and sequins and everything. It's gonna be all covered up. Okay.
I absolutely remember passing her in the hall going, hey, Reba.
I had to go to therapy.
And I was like, I don't know. It's like, dang it.
It messed me up.
I'm telling you.
So I'm walking down the hall, and here comes Chris Christopherson. He says, oh, my lands. Oh, crap, I look good.
Reba comes out in this most stunning, stunning, revealing dress, completely opposite of who you think Reba is.
And I walk on stage, and Linda Davis and I are singing Does He Love You? And I come out, and the crowd goes, and I go, oh, yeah, I look good. I know about you for a while. Now, when he leaves me, he wears a smile now. The
lighting happened to enhance her cleavage more than what we thought. You have to remember, this was before J-Lo wore her little green, you know, jungle number that was down to here.
She didn't fall out. No, there was no fallout. Let's get that straight. It was all in place, but it, anyway.
So it was a shocking moment. I know she got a lot of criticism for it.
There are always going to be some people who think that was too flashy or showed too much.
Daddy walks over to me and said, Reba, tell me the truth. Did you have that dress on backwards?
Reba didn't win a CMA award that night, but the next day, all the press talked about that red dress. And she got more press from that red dress, as crazy as it was, than if she would have won an award.
Reba's career has earned her a spot amongst music's elite. In the year 2000, she was named the number one best-selling country artist and the number two best-selling female artist of all genres behind Barbara Streisand. But there was more to do. During an unplanned layover in New York City, Reba and Narvel took a side trip to Broadway.
So he said, let's go see Annie Get Your Gun. And by intermission, we looked at each other and I said, I have got to be on that stage.
Talk about breaking out of the box. Hillbilly singer goes to Broadway and she flattened him.
I was never so entertained, impressed, and surprised in my life.
The previous people who had inhabited the role did not get good reviews. They either got ignored or they got panned. She came in and changed the whole thing around and got magnificent reviews.
She absolutely tore it up and completely changed a lot of really, you know, snobby theater Broadway minds.
Totally believed if she would have been eligible, she would have Lil Tony right here.
Then in August of 2000, she received a quirky script for a TV sitcom that would eventually be named Reba.
Husband leaves woman to marry pregnant dental hygienist mistress, finding out at the same time that their 16-year-old daughter is now pregnant with her high school sweetheart. I mean, it would have read like a Jerry Springer sort of, you know, This Week on Springer.
By the time that series came along, she had fully established the character, really, that she would be playing on that series. They were able to write for a character that had already been well established.
The second season, Reba McEntire crept into being that Reba Hart character. And the little feisty attitude and the attitude came in, and it more and more became Reba McEntire.
Reba had conquered Broadway and television. She had become an inspiration for women in all fields. In 2007, Billboard honored her as their first woman of the year.
I would say that when they gave her that award, in the back of her mind, she said, you know what? This couldn't have happened without Narvel.
All that she has done, not only with her own talents and for her own career, all the charity work that she has done, a lot of which she doesn't even talk about.
When I call her and I say, Reba, this little girl is sick. Her lifelong dream is to see Reba McEntire. Do you think she could get a backstage pass? The press won't be there. The stories won't be there. She can't write $1 million check to get a tax break. But by golly, she'll kneel down there and she'll give that kid a biggest old hug. And that's a lifelong dream to that kid. That's the things that mean most to me.
When the cameras are on and when they're off, how do they treat people? And I just think it catches up to you eventually if you're not consistent. And I think she's got it down in front and behind the scenes.
I've been out with her 100 times, and if someone asks her to take a picture, she'll stop and go right to it. I've never seen her walk off, not once. Never seen her try to hide or anything. She'll go right to him, take the picture, and stand right there. Just, she goes right into Reba mode. Sure, come right over here. Just come here.
Music, film, Broadway, television. Reba has conquered it all.
We're not surprised at what Reba does. We're just wondering when she's going to sit on the porch.
No matter what she does, no matter what little nuances she brings into her music, it is always, at the core, stone cold country.
She extended the reach of country music and sang her butt off while she was doing it.
She lives in Hollywood. She's not Hollywood. She's just a country girl that lives in Hollywood.
There's just that thing about a country girl that's going to always just be that country girl.
You want some dirt about her, but there's really no dirt to be had.
Reba is exactly who she was since she jumped off a horse to come to Music City.
Fast, furious, redhead, riding on a horse on fire.
They'll be closing the lid, and she'll still be, I've got one more song to sing.
You know, if they say, when I'm gone, if they say she was a good old gal that worked real hard, who had lots of friends, friends that loved her, and a great family that misses her, I'd be tickled with that.